got a lot of really neat things to get into in this parsha because, you know, we look at where we've been through at this point, and as we've been going through Shemot, we've been talking about Yah's. He reveals his character. He reveals who he is to his people. He brings deliverance to his people. He redeems them. And the whole purpose was to bring them to himself, you know? It's about restoration, but it's always been about restoration. You know, we're still in the process of restoring things because it's not all there yet. But there is a process the Father has us in. It's the same thing we see when we read the book Shemot, how he brought the people out, he redeemed them, brought them through the mikvah, brought them to the mountain so that he could, what? Keep them in bondage? No. So that he could reveal his ways. See, he redeemed them and brought them to himself so that he could show his desires for his people and the blessings that he had laid out for them. The interesting thing we'll see in this parsha is how the people responded to that, and we'll get there in just a minute. Let's start with the name. Mishpatim is the name of this parsha. It's the plural form of the word mishpat. Okay, it's a plural form of the word mishpat. Mishpat means a verdict, a sentence, a formal decree of something. Here's something, shofet, which is also from this word, right? The root of this word is shafat. So shofet is also from this word. Shofet is a judge. Okay, we have a parsha called shoftim, right? Judges. So what does a judge do? He issues forth mishpat. See, so these are some things that we look at. And in the Hebrew, it's all the same root because they're all related to one another. And we're going to learn to see how the Father desired to give these to his people. I mean, is it just one blast all of a sudden? Oh my gosh, you're all just so miserable here. You better step in line. Not at all. His desire was that they pursue him, that they seek him. But in order to do that, they had to learn to get along with each other. Make sense? And so this parsha Mishpatim has a lot to do about how you handle relationships. About, if you read through this parsha, you'll find a lot of disputes. Okay, here's a situation, here's how you answer it. Here's a situation, here's how you answer it. Here's a situation, here's how you answer it. And we find a lot of that. And as we live our lives, we learn that it's necessary to have these kind of things. Because if two people have a disagreement and they cannot come to any kind of resolution, then they have to go to a third party. Well, they don't have to, but if they want it resolved or to learn how to get along and work together, they need to. So they need to go to a third party, and this third party will say, okay, what's you state? Okay, well, here's what we need to do about the situation, and they do that so that life can continue to happen. Because if we're just stuck in dispute, we're not going to dwell in any kind of unity. If we're not going to dwell in any kind of unity, is the Father really going to manifest his presence in our lives? So the goal of this is not just to give you just a big list of rules or do's or don'ts. The idea is to learn from these, the character of our Father, to teach us his desires, how to handle one another in our daily lives, and get on with it. Yeah, that's his desire, because He brought them to the mountain not to stay at the mountain. He brought them to the mountain to teach them his way so he could bring them into the promise. And that's what we need to keep in mind, okay? So, Mishpatim. In this parsha, we have to understand one very important thing. These are things that the Father desired to give to Israel directly. The problem is, you know, we read about it, when God spoke, and you have the fire and the mountain and the trembling and the earthquake and the torches and the lightning. And it was a very awe-inspiring thing, okay? Why did the people respond to that? They got scared and they backed off. See, the fear of the Lord is supposed to bring you to a place of repentance so that you come closer, not to be a place of, oh, I don't want to repent, so I better back off, right? And what is happening, the people moved away and said, Moses, you go find out what God says, and then you tell us what happens, and we'll do that. Because they didn't want to hear it for themselves. They couldn't handle it. So Moses says, okay, this is what we'll do then. So he goes to find out what the Father says. And you know, that's this parsha. These are the things that the Father desired to tell the people directly, but they backed away. Isn't it interesting that they're all things about killing your pride, learning to dwell in unity with one another, how to handle situations when we feel wronged? These are the things we didn't want to hear, and these are the things we still don't want to hear. It's just as it was then, it is now. But understand that it was the Father's desire in His heart to speak these things to us directly. Okay? All right. Exodus 21:1. So these are the rulings you are to present to them. Again, just to make the point, another interesting thing is it does not say Eli HaMishpatim Asher. It says Ve'eli. The V at the beginning of the word means and. So literally in Hebrew, this whole thing starts with and. But you don't start a sentence with a conjunction. It's a good thing it's not English, huh? And these are the judgments that you are to put before the people of Israel. So this word and does something. What does it do? It connects with what came before. And so what came before? The words that Yah spoke from the mountain. See, these were not meant to be separated. These were meant to be given together. But again, the people backed off. And it's important to notice that just because the people backed off, God did not stop speaking. Just because we don't want to hear what God has to say and we back off doesn't mean He's done. He's still speaking. We need to see what He says. Right? There's a few that would lay down their lives to go in, press in, to see what the desires in the hearts of the Father is. But even that, Moses went and found out what God said, brought it back to the people, and the people said, meh. Or at least you would think so, by the way we treat it today. See, we say, you know, the Ten Commandments are things where most believers would say is, you know, relevant or important, or at least nine of them, right? And so we have to learn that God wasn't just speaking those. That's just a small portion of what He wanted for us. He has so much more that He desires. We push in. What's the purpose and the point of the whole thing? Relationship. It's always about relationship. Okay? All right. Psalm 82:1 says, Elohim stands in the divine assembly. There with the Elohim He judges. Think about that for a second. Well, Elohim means God, not necessarily. Elohim is translated as God, but Elohim means someone in authority. Okay, so someone who's been given a position of authority. So Elohim can also be used in certain places in Scripture as judges. Someone who has been given a position. So Elohim, God, stands in the divine assembly, but there with the Elohim, the judges, He judges. Who judges? God judges. How can we give forth righteous judgment if we don't know what righteous judgment is? How can the judges give forth that which is right and good if we're not taught what is right and good? Right? It says in Proverbs 28:5, evil man understand not judgment, but they that seek the Lord understand all things. When it says they understand not judgment, literally it's they do not understand or they do not discern mishpat. And this parsha teaches you how to discern mishpat. But we don't want to look at those things. We want to give forth judgments by our own standards. And our standard, let's just face it, it's flexible. By according to what each of us desires or wants at the time. God, not so much. His word is the foundation and the bedrock of everything in our lives. Right? And that's what we need to learn. Again, Exodus 21:4. So if you purchase a Hebrew slave, he is to work 6 years. Now what does this have to do with relationship? Okay, here's the thing, guys. You know, it's not like, oh, God is promoting slavery. No, not necessarily. Even saying it is a Hebrew servant. The word that's often translated as slave is the same word used for servant. Okay? But understand what's happening here. Notice he specifically even says a Hebrew. In other words, one of your brothers. Okay? If one of your brothers comes to you and he says, I have a debt that I can't pay, can you pay it for me and I'll work it off? In essence, that's kind of what this is. Okay? There's two main reasons why someone would go into something like this. Either one, He was poor and had no means to do what he needed to do, so someone did this for him. They brought him under their wings, so to speak, and brought them under their care. They cared for them, and they would work for them. Or they owed a debt that they could not pay, whether by they just didn't have the means to do it, they borrowed, they can't pay it back, or even by theft. Because if someone stole something, well, now, depending on what it was, you either pay back four times, twice, or seven, or depending on the situation, right? I don't have that. Great, you can work it off. See? A lot of things through Scripture is very productive in people's lives. You know, you don't just discount people and kick them to the curb. You know? So, there's two main things here. And regardless of which one of these there was, the point is that if you were to take a Hebrew servant, they worked for you for how long? 6 years. And there's a time coming when he is given his freedom without having to pay anything. That's important too. Matter of fact, as you read through the scriptures, you find out that when you sent them away, you had to send them away with stuff. You couldn't just say, okay, your time's up, get out. You actually sent them away with the things that they needed to start their life on their own. See, so it was very productive for both parties involved there. Okay? Moving on. He served for 6 years and then he was released. We find in Deuteronomy 15. So if your brother, a Hebrew man or a Hebrew woman, be sold unto you and he served 6 years, then in the seventh year he is to be let go free from you. And when you send him out free from you, you shall not let him go away empty-handed. You will furnish him liberally out of your flock, out of your floor, and out of your winepress, so the Lord your God has blessed you that you give to him. There's an old Hebrew idiom that the Hebrew who owns a slave is himself a slave. In other words, it's your responsibility to care for your fellow brother. If they're in your house, you care for them. See? So it's not quite the stigma that we have here, you know, today. Okay? Moving on. Exodus 21:5. Nevertheless, if the slave declares, now this is interesting, I love my master, my wife, and my children, and I don't want to go free. You have the opportunity to be free. I'll set you up for everything you need. I'll give you a new job, give you the stuff you need to get your own place. There you go. No. I love my master. I love my family. I'd rather stay here. Think about that. This is what we call, and what many of us have heard in Scripture, it's called a bondservant. Okay? And where do we find things like that given? We find it in the Brit Hadashah, right? In the New Testament, Paul says, I am a bondservant. This is something that we need to understand. See, when the Father redeems us, we even use the terminology, I'm not my own, I'm bought with a price, right? So if I'm not my own, that means I belong to somebody else. Who do I belong to? Him. If I belong to him, then whose authority do I operate in? His. If I decide to do my own thing, it doesn't work that way. I do what he says. See, a bondservant didn't have the choice of what they decided, what they would and would not do. You hear me? When we give our lives to him and he redeems us, we really don't have the choice. I mean, we still can go out and do, but we would be doing so in rebellion, wouldn't we? We could still walk away, but we would be doing it in rebellion. He tells us what he desires for us. And if we are truly a servant of the Most High, which we say we are, then we should do what he says, not what we think. Because sometimes what he says is way above what we think. And so even if it doesn't make sense to us, we need to just follow him, right? I guarantee you there were times, we even see it in Scripture, when Yeshua's disciples said, we don't get it. So did they stop following? You know, we find places in Scripture where many did. But there were some that stuck with him, right? Okay, so he first came to serve because of a sense of obligation. Now think about this. He first came to serve because of a sense of obligation. He did not come to serve this master because he loved him. He came to serve him because of other circumstances. As an example, there was a debt he owed he could not pay. This man said, I can pay your debt for you, but you would come under my authority. I say, well, that seems like the best option I've got because I owe way beyond that I can pay. So I will come under your authority. You pay my debt and I will give my servitude to you. In the process of serving you, I've come to learn your character, to know what kind of a person you are, and come to see I actually love you. And so then, when the time comes when I say I can be free, I say, I would rather walk in the freedom I have here. Guys, that's us. When we first give our heart to the Father, it's not like we say, oh, we first came to him because we love him so much. No, you didn't know him. Someone had told you, whatever the circumstances are, most of us just understood a need for repentance. Most of us just understood there was something that was in our life. There was sin in our life. There was no way to get to him in any other way but to surrender ourselves to him. Whether it be we just realized the debt we couldn't pay, or whether the penalty of hell, or whether just to see, wow, this is such an amazing thing. I want to be a part of this kingdom. Whatever it is, you didn't love it at first, but you grew to love it. That's maturity. That's growing. That's a process of time. You know? Even then, you know, it's like the eyes meet across the room. I love him. No, it's infatuation. Okay? Love is not just an emotion. Love is something that nurtures and grows and develops. It's a commitment. And so after a period of time, you see, I love my master. I love my family. I don't want to leave. You know what that's called? Discipleship. And that's when we come to him in that way. Romans 3:10, as it is written, there is none righteous, though not one. But part of that debt we couldn't pay. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Yeshua, our Messiah. Matthew 6:12, we pray, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. So the idea of the wages of sin is death, yeah, okay, we say a wage is something that we're given, but it's also a debt, because death sows more penalty. So there's a penalty that is beyond us. If we surrender ourselves to him, we can escape that penalty, but at the price of laying our life down for him. After all, he laid his life down for us, right? Exodus 21:6. So then his master is to bring him before God, and there at the door or doorpost, his master is to pierce his ear with an awl, and the man will be his slave for life. This is pretty interesting. So the servant gave away his own will. The servant gave away his own, you know, to be his own man. He gave it away, you know? He stayed because he loved his family and his master. He declared commitment to the one that he served. And that's just the same way we approach these things today. After the declaration of loyalty, where people would say, if you confess with your mouth, if you hear what I'm telling you, okay? It goes beyond confessing with your mouth. Then there's an action involved. Now you live your life differently, right? They go before God and the judges, because this is at the doorpost or the gates, right? Where do the judges judge in the cities? At the gates, at the doorposts, because they are the ones who would allow in and out what was going in and out. They are the ones who would allow something or disallow something. Okay? So there they go, and they're at the door, or even the doorpost. What's the doorpost? What's the significance of the doorpost? Think about Passover. What is applied to the doorpost? Now, the word for doorpost in Scripture is mezuzah. We think the box that we put on the doorpost. Literally, mezuzah is the actual doorpost. Okay? And it says, and you are to put on the mezuzah the words of Yah. Think of the Shema. And you were to write these words that I am giving you on your doorposts and on your gates. So on the gates and on the doorposts, you have the word of Yah being written. So that as you go in and as you come out, you were to have a reminder of the one that you serve and his rulings, his word, his decree, his word over your life. Not just that, but then there's also the blood of the Lamb that is applied. So on the door, you have the word and the blood working together as a reminder that he is the one that redeemed you, and we now walk by his word. Now, Yeshua said, I am the door. You see how it fits? So then they take him, and then his ear is pierced with an awl, and the blood applied at the doorpost, and he will be a bondservant. Think about this. The one who laid his life down will be pierced through. At the doorpost, the word and the blood. Romans 1, Philippians 1, Titus 1. Again, Shaul calls himself a servant. This word is translated as bondservant. The same word that we would use in the scripture we just read in Shemot. Leviticus 25:5. Yah said, for unto me the children of Israel are servants. They are my servants who I brought forth out of the land of Egypt. And then a reminder, I am the Lord your God. Again, there's sometimes we need reminders that we serve him. It's not the other way around. See, so many people today in life, the way they live their life and the way they pray and talk to him, you think that he served them. No, we serve him. And we can't forget that. You know, it's like coming before him. You know, we misunderstand the whole phrasing of where it says we can come boldly before the throne. You know, what that means is that to know and to be assured of who you are in him, that you are redeemed, then you can come before him in that. You don't have to doubt what he's done for you. It does not mean that you can kick down the door, throw him a list of demands, and say, I better have it by lunch. It doesn't work that way. You serve him, not the other way around. Romans 6. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are the slaves of whom you obey? That just makes sense, doesn't it? Now, think about this. In a lot of places in Scripture as well, where it uses the term slave or servant, can also be translated as employee-employer kind of relationships, okay? And so even if you use it in this way, don't you know that when you have a job, when you go to that job, you are submitted to the one who gave you that job, right? You don't get a job over here and go over there and work and get your paycheck from that guy back there, right? So what Shaul is saying is, don't you know that what you give yourself to, you serve? And then he says, you can either be a slave to sin, producing disobedience and death, or you can be a slave to righteousness, producing life. Think about that. So you were a slave to sin. Here you were, and then God redeemed you. He brought you out, and now that you're free, you're a slave. See, we think now that we're redeemed us, and now that we're free, we can just go do whatever we want. No, that was back when you were a slave to sin. But now that we are a servant of the Most High, we serve him. We walk in his ways. We walk in his righteousness. And to walk in his righteousness does not mean that I can do whatever I want. To walk in his righteousness means that he laid out a path for us to walk on. Right? So do you not know if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are the slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that you who were once slaves of sin have become what? What's this word? Obedient from the heart of the standard of teaching to which you were committed, and you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of righteousness. Okay? Verse 19. I'm speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations, for just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to lawlessness, leading to more lawlessness, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness, leading to sanctification. For when you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. Think about this. When you were a slave to sin, you were free from righteousness. But then when you were a slave to righteousness, you were free from sin. What happens if he frees us from sin, but we never submit ourselves to righteousness? See? Verse 21. But what fruit were you getting at that time from the things of which you are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. But now you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God. The fruit you get leads you to sanctification, and its end is eternal life. Amen. All right. Psalm 40, verse 6. Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, my ears you have opened. Now this doesn't mean that God hates the sacrifices that he instituted. No, what it means is his desire from the beginning is just to have that walking, personal, one-on-one relationship like he did with Adam in the garden. But because of sin, he instituted another means to try to be represented before God. But his desire from the beginning was that relationship. See, and this is what he's saying in Psalms. My ears you opened. You could even say pierced. Because I belong to him. And he says, so then I said, lo, I come in the volume of the book. It is written of me. I delight to do your will, O my Elohim. Your law is within my heart. When we submit ourselves to him, he will open our ears. You know, we even read as well in other places in Scripture. Open my, what? My heart to, and open my eyes, open my ears, so that I can see wonderful things in your Torah. Right? Philippians 2, 5. So let this mind be in you, which is also in Messiah Yeshua, who subsisting in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. He emptied himself, taking on the form of a bondservant. You know, we read in the Scripture that as he grew, he learned obedience. And he grew and became strong, right? So having become in the likeness of men and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, having become what? Obedient. Even until death, even to the death of the cross. Because of this also, God highly exalted him and gave him a name above every name. So back to continuing with Mishpatim, okay? 22:21. You must neither wrong nor oppress a foreigner living among you, for you yourselves were foreigners in the land of Egypt. Now, as we continue on this, remember, we first get the reminder that we belong to him. Okay? And so what he's telling you is because you belong to him and because there are foreigners around you, do not oppress them because you were foreigners in the land of Egypt. In other words, don't forget where you came from. Don't forget about your past and what's been handed to you. But the problem with that is sometimes when we start remembering things of the past, we often go back there. Don't remember where you came from for the sake of going back. Remember where you came from to see how far the Father has brought you. And always look forward. Walk now, but always look ahead. And there's a point to this. Okay? Matthew 5:46. What reward do you get if you love only those who love you? Even tax collectors do that. And if you are friendly to only your friends, are you doing anything out of the ordinary? Even the goyim do that. You need to show a supernatural love to those around you. And why do I say a supernatural love? Because sometimes we don't want to. And that's part of what he told us to do. To show his love, his light to those around us. Not to oppress those around us because they're not like us. But show them the better way. And here's the problem. By showing them the better way, we often think that means we have to be louder. Not necessarily. Just means we need to make sure that we're living the way we're supposed to be. I'm not telling you don't say anything either. I'm just saying most often we're quick to jump and say and speak when we actually just need to be living it. Right? Do not oppress the foreigner. Remember that you at one time were estranged from Yah. Read Ephesians chapter 2. That you who were once far away from the things of God have been brought near in the Messiah. Don't forget where you were and where you're going. So you are to show the way to those around you. Acts 13:47. So the Lord has commanded us, saying, I have made you a light for the Gentiles that you may bring salvation to the ends of the earth. I've made you a light to the nations so you can bring the message to the ends of the earth. And when the Gentiles heard this, they began rejoicing and glorifying the word of the Lord. And as many as were appointed to eternal life believed. And the word of the Lord was spreading throughout the whole region. He says, don't oppress them because I've made you to be a light to them. And the whole point of being a light to them means that, guys, at some point, they may want to be redeemed. And the last thing we need, I mean, I've heard people, you know, do this as well. It's like, well, I knew a believer once, but man, I don't want to serve any God that guy serves. We don't need that kind of testimony. You know? Isaiah 42:4. He will not grow faint or be discouraged till he has established justice in the earth, and the coastlands wait for his Torah. And the coastlands wait for his Torah. That means those places that are way far off are waiting and yearning for the Torah to come to them. Thus says God, the Lord who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and what comes from it, who gives breath to the people on it and the spirit to those who walk in it. I am the Lord. I have called you in righteousness. I will take you by the hand and keep you, and I will give you as a covenant for the people. I will give, not just give you a covenant for the people, I will give you as a covenant to the people. That means that you can play a role in people coming to faith. You can play a role in your light shining and letting those around you know it and to let them experience the God that you serve. You can play a role in that. Yeshua said, let your light shine before men. Right? You say, you know, a city hid on a hill cannot be hid kind of a thing. And then I love this part where it says you don't take a light and you put it under a bed. No, you don't, because, you know, most beds were straw. Most light was fire. In other words, you try to hide your light, and you might end up without somewhere to sleep. But he says, I gave you to be a covenant to the people, a light to the nations, to do what? To open blind eyes. To bring out the prisoners from the dungeons and from the prison, those who sit in darkness. Okay, back to Exodus 23. So he says, you are not to repeat false rumors. Do not join hands with the wicked by offering perjured testimony. Think about that. You are not to repeat false rumors. Well, here's the thing. How are we to know if it's false or not if we just hear something? Better off to keep your mouth shut. Just saying. Two, do not follow the crowd when it does what is wrong. Because majority rule most often isn't holy. Because the majority most often isn't holy. And don't allow the popular view to sway you into offering testimony for any cause if the effect will be to pervert justice. Ephesians 4:31 says, let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Because here's something. If you're listening to false reports, if you're listening to it, at some point, you're going to repeat it. And when you repeat it, you're going to be planting seeds of falsehood to somebody else's life, and they don't need that. You know, Scripture tells us in so many places to not slander your brother. And be careful of these things, right? Okay, keep moving. 23:20, I am sending an angel ahead of you to guard you on the way and bring you into the place that I have prepared. Word for angel is malak. Malak, it means someone that is dispatched. They're dispatched as a deputy, dispatched as a messenger, or dispatched with some kind of authority for a purpose, okay? The word malak can also mean king, it can mean a prophet, it can mean ambassador. It just means someone that has been dispatched for a purpose, has been dispatched with authority, all right? And he says, pay attention to him, listen to what he says, and do not rebel against him, because he will not forgive any wrongdoing, or he will not forgive willful sin of yours. Because my name resides in him. But if you shema to what he says and do everything I will tell you. Notice, shema to what he says and do what I tell you. In other words, he's going to speak what I say. Right? Then I will be an enemy to your enemies and a foe to your foes. And when my angel goes ahead of you and brings you to the Amorite, the Hittite, the Perizzite, the Kenani, the Hivi, he says, wherever I bring you, I will make an end to your adversaries. Which, keep in mind, means that at some point, this angel is going to lead them into areas of battle. But they're going to have to fight. But they will overcome if they continue to follow. Okay? The interesting thing is this. Can angels forgive sin? No. So he said, that he will not forgive any sin of yours if you rebel against him. Which implies he can forgive sin. So if an angel can forgive sin, well, they can't. So who is it? You know, back to Mark. Mark 2:7. Why does this man speak blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God? They had a point. Verse 10 says, but that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. The people are freaking out. Who could forgive sins but God? Yeshua's like, watch this. Exodus 23, again, verse 24. You are not to worship their gods. No matter the places where he brings you, you are not to worship their gods. Because in the midst of the battle, let's just face the fact, you get distracted sometimes. Right? So in the distractions, you could be caught up by the silver or the gold or the shiny, sparkly idols all around you. Don't let them catch you up. Okay? Because sometimes, you know, something's like that, it gets our attention. Don't let it. Don't let it fall for these things. He says, you are not to worship their gods. You are not to serve them. You are not to follow their practices. Rather, you are to demolish them completely and smash their standing stones to pieces. And you are to serve Adonai, your God, and he will bless your food and water, and I will take sickness away from among you. The blessing is from serving him. Okay? Zephaniah 1, verse 4. So I will crush Judah and Jerusalem with my fist and destroy every last trace of their Baal worship. So what context are we talking about? Idolatry being judged. And I will put an end to their idolatrous priests so that even the memory of them will disappear. For they go up to their roofs and they bow down to the sun, the moon, and the stars. They claim to follow Yahweh, but then they worship idols too. And I will destroy those who used to worship me, but no longer do. They no longer ask for the Lord's guidance or seek my blessings. Verse 7. Stand in silence in the presence of the sovereign Lord, for the awesome day of the Lord's judgment is near. The Lord has prepared his people for a great slaughter and has chosen their executioners. Verse 8. On that day of judgment, says the Lord, I will punish the leaders and princes of Judah that have led them astray and all those following pagan customs. That's pretty strong, isn't it? Back to Exodus 24. To Moshe, Adonai said, come up to Adonai, you, Aaron, Nadav, and Avihu, and the 70 elders of Israel, and prostrate yourselves at a distance. If we've been reading through this, we've seen that Moshe took the 70 elders, they made declaration of the word of Torah because they are the ones who would be taught the Torah to teach the people, right? And they're the ones to make the judgments between the people. Remember, leaders over tens, fifties, hundreds, thousands, right? And so as Moshe was to go to the mountain, they were establishing authority down here so that they can continue living their life and preparing themselves for what was to come. Okay? So he says, while Moshe alone approaches Adonai, the others are not to approach and the people are not to go up with him. Remember, the people backed away. Moses, you go get this. So this is what they're going to do. Right? So Moshe came and told the people everything Adonai had said, including all the rulings, and the people answered with one voice, we will obey every word Adonai has spoken. So Moshe wrote down the words of Adonai. He rose early in the morning, built an altar at the base of the mountain, and set upright 12 large stones to represent the 12 tribes of Israel. He sent the youth group out to make burnt offerings and sacrifice peace offerings. Really? Okay. He sent the teens out, good strapping, you know. Verse 6, Moshe took half of the blood and he put it in the basin, the other half of the blood he splashed against the altar. And then he took the book of the covenant, he took the what? The book of the covenant, and he read it aloud, so that the people could hear, and they responded, everything that Adonai has spoken, na'aseh v'nishma. Na'aseh v'nishma means we will do and we will hear. The interesting thing is the do came before hear. How can you do if you don't hear? The idea is they've already heard what was said. They say, we will do and we will hear. Meaning, as the Lord continues to speak, we will continue to do. So we will do what he has said, and as we hear, we will continue to do. Shema is not just to listen, it's to hear with the intent of being obedient to what you've heard. Okay? They said, all that God has spoken, we will do, and we will obey, is really what they were saying. So Moshe took the blood, sprinkled it on the people, and he said, now Moshe took what? The blood. He took half in the basin, two basins, and half he sprinkled on the people, the other half he sprinkled on the altar. Okay? And then he says, he took this, this is the, what? Blood of the covenant. I thought that was just in the New Testament. This is the blood of the covenant. Now listen to this. Which Adonai has made with you in accordance with these words. In other words, the blood combined with the words that God spoke is what is working together here as one testimony. If you say you have the blood, but you refuse the word, you have not accepted it. If you say you have the word, but refuse the blood, you have not accepted it. They work together. This is the covenant. Moshe took the offerings, put it in the two basins, half the blood was splashed on the altar, representing the people being dedicated to him. Okay? The life is in the what? Blood. Yeah, I can't forget that. The life is in the blood. So this is the life being put on the altar. Okay? The other half was splashed on the people, representing the life of Yahweh being applied to the people. There was a connection between the people, the altar, the blood, and the word. Okay? And then he made a declaration. He said, this is the blood of the covenant that Adonai has made with you in accordance with all these words. In other words, the blood and the word go together with the dedication to Yahweh. Okay? Revelation 12:11 we see, and they overcame him by what? The blood of the Lamb and the what? Word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death. They laid down their life according to the word that God had given. That's their testimony. Revelation 14:12. Here is a call for the endurance of the saints. So who are the saints? Those who what? Keep the commandments of God and their faith in Yeshua. That's in Revelation, guys. Hebrews 9. So this is why the first covenant too was inaugurated with blood. After Moshe had proclaimed every command of the Torah to the people, he took the blood of the calves, some of the water, and they used the scarlet wool, the hyssop, to sprinkle both the scroll itself and all the people. And he said, this is the blood of the covenant which God has ordained for you. Likewise, he sprinkled with the blood both the tent and all the things used in its ceremonies. In fact, according to the Torah, almost everything is purified with blood. Indeed, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. Okay, Matthew 26. So he took the cup of wine, he made the bracha, he made the blessing, and he gave it to them saying, all of you drink from it, for this is my blood, which ratifies the new covenant, my blood shed on behalf for many, so that they may have their sins forgiven. So that phrase, blood of the covenant, you think Yeshua may be going back to referencing something that may have happened at Sinai? Exodus 24:9. So Moshe, Aaron, Nadav, and Abihu, and the 70, the leaders went up. And this is pretty interesting. And they saw the God of Israel. And under his feet was like sapphire stone pavement, as clear as the sky itself. And he did not reach out his hand against these notables of Israel. On the contrary, they saw God even as they were eating and drinking. It's not like, okay, we go to the mountain. Wow, we saw God. Let's throw a party. No. They made the offerings at the mountain. Right? They were to partake of these peace offerings. They made burnt offerings and peace offerings. The peace offering, you actually eat. Portion goes to the Father. You get portions back that you eat from. These leaders partook of the peace offering at the feet of the Most High. And it says that they saw the God of Israel. And literally it just means like they saw his feet. Okay? Didn't like you say everything. It says they saw it. He saw it. He was standing on sapphire. They saw the God of Israel. It's important to notice this too. This is the very first time this phrase is used. The first time we see the phrase the God of Israel is right after they made commitment to covenant and right after they partook of the offerings and the blood was applied. Then they were called then the God of Israel is given to them. So if no one could see God and live, how did they live? Two thoughts. One, they could have seen Yeshua. Or the men who climbed the mountain to partake of the covenant meal had just done what? Declared covenant, declared loyalty, commitment to the Most High. What did they have on them? They were sprinkled with the blood of the covenant. So they were covered with the blood of the covenant. Remember, they were sprinkled with the blood of the covenant. So as they approached the Most High, they were covered with the blood of the covenant, allowing them to approach. Any different for us? Okay, Exodus 24:12. Adonai said to Moshe, come up to me on the mountain and stay there, and I will give you the stone tablets with the Torah and the mitzvot I have written on them so that you can teach them. Okay? So Moshe got up, and also Yehoshua, his assistant, his minister, you know, so Moshe was there with him at this point, and Moses went up to go in, and Joshua stood, and kind of interesting, guys, how we see how Joshua is called Moses' minister. It means he served Moses. You know, today we think we're above serving any man. We need to humble ourselves. We need to see that as believers and as children of the Most High, it is worthy to serve each other. And Moshe went to the mountain of God, and to the leaders he said, stay here for us until we come back to you. See, Aaron and Hur are with you, and whoever has a problem should go to them. In other words, he established Aharon and Hur that were there. And as Moshe went to the mountain, he said, here are these two men. If there are any situations that arise, anything that happens, you go to these men until I return. Okay? Why? So that they would not be like sheep without a shepherd. Right? Moshe went to the mountain to receive the Torah. Before he left, he set order so that they would not be like sheep without a shepherd. Because the sheep need a shepherd. Because without it, the wolves like to come in, right? Not to mention, sheep like to go wandering, you know? Numbers 27:15. Moses spoke to the Lord, saying, let the Lord, the God of the spirits of all flesh, do what? Set a man over the congregation. Today, we have, you know, more and more people who are just saying, oh, you know, we don't need any man to teach us. You know, okay, fine. I'll give you that. Does God speak to you? Sure. Does His Spirit speak? Sure. The problem is when you take this scripture, if you take it out of context, because he's speaking of a time that isn't here yet. Because he says, all men will know me, and I myself will teach them. Are we there yet? Do all know him? No. See, so again, it's a context thing. And so here we have, let the Lord God, who knows everyone, set up a leader among the assembly. Why? So he can rule over them? No. So he can be there for their protection, for their safety, to help lead them to go in and out of the pastures where they need to be. That was it. Now here's the problem. Have there been a lot of people that have misused and abused that? Definitely. But does that change what God said? Not at all. You know, we live in a society today where it's like, ain't no man going to tell me what to do. There's a problem with that. It's called pride. God said we need to submit to people that are there to help us to grow. Right? So, verse 17, so he may, here again, go out before them and may go in before them and may lead them out and bring them in. That's the idea. That the shepherd will be leading the people to the pastures where they need to be and will be helping them to establish them, to build them, to give them what they need, okay? So that the congregation of the Lord be not as sheep which have no shepherd. Matthew 9:36. When Yeshua saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion on them because they fainted and they were scattered abroad as what? Sheep having no shepherd. John 21:14. So it's now the third time Yeshua had appeared to the Talmudim, to the disciples, after being raised from the dead. And after breakfast, Yeshua said to Shimon, Kephas, Simon Peter, Shimon bar Yochanan, do you love me more than these? And he replied, yes, Lord, you know I'm your friend. And he said to him, feed my lambs. A second time he said, Shimon bar Yochanan, do you love me? He said, yes, Lord, I'm your friend. And he said, shepherd my sheep. And the third time he said, Shimon bar Yochanan, are you my friend? And Shimon was hurt that he questioned him a third time. Are you my friend? So he replied, Lord, you know everything. You know I'm your friend. And Yeshua said, feed my sheep. Even as Yeshua was preparing to leave, he was still establishing people there to help the people to grow. The desire of the Father is that the people would not be left alone. That they dwell within the community, that they learn how to walk together, they learn to care for one another, they learn to look out for the good of the other person more than their own, and they seek to glorify the Father in all of it. The problem is, in the midst of life and these things happening, we get in little arguments and tiffs and little things happen, and we need someone there to say, you're both wrong. That we need to keep our eyes and our focus on the Father and to help in those situations so that we can take another step, so that we can keep moving. Because you shouldn't be standing still. Amen? Amen. It's a journey. We're not stopping at the mountain. This is part of the process. The next step is going into the promise. But before we can fulfill it, we have to prepare ourselves as a place for him to dwell. That's what we're getting into soon. Amen?
Well, if this teaching has blessed you, I want you to check out our other resources. You can check out our website at www.ruachonline.com. And there's links there to other resources that are available to you, other teachings, other books, other offerings. You can go to YouTube, Facebook, all of these things from our website. And check us out, because if they enjoyed this teaching, there's going to be much more that hopefully will bless you as well. Thank you. Hi, this is Dr. David Jones from Ruach Ministries International, and I've got some exciting news for you. We have a new series coming out, 6-part series of the Gospel According to Abraham. Abraham? What does he got to do with the gospel? Well, you're going to have to find out, aren't you? The thing is, Galatians 3 says that the gospel was proclaimed to Abraham. So what does that mean for a believer today? What does that mean to a person who is not Jewish? What does that mean to a person who is Jewish? What does that mean for all of us today? Well, check it out. It's a good series, and it'll be coming your way soon. For more information, you can check out our website at www.ruachonline.com. Hi, this is Dr. David Jones here. I just want to say we do have some other resources available to you, one of which is a book entitled Famine, Walking and Blessing in the Time of Famine. It's based out of Amos 8, 11 and 12, talking about there's a famine of hearing the word of the Lord. So what is that famine? Does it mean the word of the Lord is not being proclaimed, or does it mean there's a famine of actually listening to it? Food for thought, isn't it? Well, if you want to know more, check it out. Go to www.ruachonline.com, and there's a link on our homepage. Just click and it'll take you to more information on the book entitled Famine, Walking and Blessing in a Time of Famine. Well, how important are the feasts of the Lord? I think we can say that if the Lord set out a banquet, set out a table, and invited you to come be a partaker, would we answer? Would we hear? Would we go? Or would we blow them off because we have something more important to do? Well, that's what this book is. The king invites you to his table. Are we going to answer the call? The feast of the Lord, appointed times where the Lord has said he wants to meet with us face to face. Will we heed? Will we answer? Will we go? Check it out, www.ruachonline.com. On the homepage, there is a link to take you for more information. The king invites you to his table.